This is the Ever Given. At a quarter of a mile long and towering as high as a 20-story block of flats, it's big. Ridiculously big.
The gargantuan Ever Given.
A giant container ship wedged from bank to bank.
So when it got stuck in the Suez Canal for 6 days back in March, it held up nearly 200,000 tons of cargo, from fresh produce and electronic devices to IKEA furniture, leaving customers all around the world without their orders. So if a single megaship could disrupt our global supply chain that easily, maybe bigger isn't always better. Here's one of the first container ships in the 1930s. It's just a converted oil tanker. And from then on, you might notice there's a bit of a trend. This continued up until the present day, when we have megaships, the biggest of which is 400 meters long. To understand what exactly is driving this race to build the biggest ships, we need to talk about the main players, and that's the shipping line companies.
Well, for me, one of the key moments is 2010, after the financial crisis, when the large shipping company Maersk decided to go one step bigger and ordered a new generation of ships called the Triple E ships. These were basically ships that were able to carry 18,000 containers at the time. It was Maersk that started that, basically thinking that that would help give them even more dominance over the market.
The simple explanation for what's behind this is it's a classic arms race to reap the most benefits from an economy of scale. This basically means that the bigger the container ship, the more containers it can carry, and the cheaper the transportation costs for each container. But in this case, it's not that simple.
In part, they were right, but what they probably didn't foresee is that it would also lead to more problems that we're now seeing in the supply chain.
Simply put, with bigger ships comes bigger problems. For starters, megaships need places to dock, and these places need deeper access channels, stronger quay walls, and larger equipment. But these are expensive adaptations, which is a problem for many ports, because they're publicly owned.
What ship owners would like is that the ports obviously invest more. Ship owners, they benefit from these megaships, but the costs of the megaships, they are basically borne by others.
So governments find themselves in a position where they have to justify extra investment in port infrastructure, even though the public won't get much in return. Another problem is the increased risk to the goods that megaships carry. Megaships go slower than other vessels, and they have fewer places to dock, so there are more chances for things to go terribly wrong. Like in November 2020, when a Japanese container ship, the One Apis, lost 1,800 containers of its cargo overboard. And the losses are going up. Between last November and March, ships in the Pacific lost more than twice the number of containers than they usually lose in a whole year. On top of that, megaships are also a bigger target for piracy and cybercrime. And of course, they can always get stuck. Finally, the biggest consequence of the boom in megaships, and the main reason behind recent price hikes and delays, is the power of alliances. When shipping line company Maersk sought to dominate the industry with its fleet of Triple E ships, the other shipping lines weren't going to just sit back and let them monopolize world trade. So they got together and formed alliances.
The Korean shipping industry has announced a plan to form a strategic alliance.
So all the 10 major carriers are now in these three alliances, and the alliances, they control basically around 90% of all the east-west trades, which are the main trades that exist in container shipping. And the risk, I think, of that very close coordination is they could control the market in a way that isn't good for consumers or producers.
Having such a huge amount of control over global trade means these companies can raise prices or reduce capacity when it suits them. But the risks don't end there. Many of these companies have the ambition to become global supply chain integrators. This means they want to be involved in every step of getting your online shopping from the factory to your door.
They do hinterland transportation, so they have trucking companies, logistics operators. So the risk of a few companies that control whole supply chains is that of course, if one company fails, or if one part of that company fails, whole supply chains could actually fail.
The shipping industry's race to build the biggest vessels shows no sign of slowing down. And as such, global trade is becoming increasingly and precariously controlled by a small alliance of companies.